You know what we can say pretty inarguably is that Aamir Khan is, in the history of Indian cinema, one of the great defining personalities and characters. There are very few stars today who would actually leave, bequeath a legacy that matches Aamir's legacy. There's lots of interesting things to be. Most film stars, as people who have known film stars will tell you, that film stars are an incredibly vapid and boring lot of people. I mean, Aamir is one of those odd people with whom you can engage, and the fact of that comes through in the cinema he makes and the cinema he backs. It's a pretty extraordinary achievement. The body of work that he's produced in the last 10 years, I don't think it can be matched in the history of Indian cinema. We have to really go back a long way to look at the great auteurs and actors, the Gurudats and the Raj Kapoors, to see this kind of 360-degree engagement with the business of making films, with a deeper understanding, and to be a big screen star oneself. So they've been great directors and they've been fantastic actors like Amitabh Bachchan and Shah Rukh Khan, but to find an engagement that goes both behind the camera, goes all the way back to scripting, now producing, funding, for someone who's a genuine 24-karat megastar himself, that's pretty extraordinary. So I think we're very fortunate that Aamir has actually come here. I'm actually going to go into the stuff that we seldom get to hear. What I want to understand from you, Aamir, is first of all, I see your career as having two distinct phases. There's a pre-Lagaan phase, and then there's a post-Lagaan phase. Clearly, there's something that happens at that point which elevates you into a different space in your head and a different space vis-a-vis your vocation. Can you share with this audience what happens pre-Lagaan and post-Lagaan, and what is the shift that takes place that moves you into a different space altogether as a cinema person?
You know, Tarun, I've been asked this earlier, and I don't have an answer. Because from where I am,
I have been working the same way right through my career. I have always picked scripts that I've liked, and sometimes in the making of the film, we haven't ended up making what we set out to, which has been disappointing, but at other times we have achieved what we set out to, and that is very satisfying. I've always done that, and maybe, you know, I suppose all of us, you know, grow as people and we kind of change as people, and so maybe around, you know, that time I was changing more or whatever, I don't know. But I mean, I've always done films that I've enjoyed doing. I mean, Sarfarosh, for example, was before Lagaan. I think Jojita Voi Sikandar is a great story, and that's one of my earlier films, or even Rangila. Perhaps what did happen is that with each year that I was in the film industry and with each success that I kept getting, it gave me more and more strength to be able to do even more what I wanted, or to go a step further in taking a chance. I remember when I was producing Lagaan, it was a script that nobody liked, and I mean, I just loved the script, and it was a very difficult decision for me to produce that film, because while I loved the script, at that point of time, my mind was telling me that this is a film that, you know, based on what is happening around us, it's not going to work. But I just loved it. And then I said, yaar, when I look at, you know, film people who I admire and whose work I've always loved, and I've seen the kind of risks they've taken probably in their times of their careers. And I said, yaar, if I really do love their work and admire them, then I must show the same courage that they have shown and just do what I feel like doing. And so Lagaan, in that sense, was perhaps one of the big decisions for me of actually producing it myself and backing something which was so unusual. Today we look at Lagaan, and you know, in today's sensibility of our cinema, Lagaan is very acceptable.
Yeah.
But when I was in 99 saying yes to the project, it was a huge risk. So I think with each year, with each success, I think I got more strength to do what I felt like doing. Yeah.
But two things happen very often when people taste success. One is they become even more cautious. Most people become even more cautious, yeah, because they want to protect the success. So what's the kind of gene that's working here which says, all right, I've done really well, You know, most people, when they have a successful product, are afraid of the next one because they think they're going to be tested against what's gone
by. They
were much more to lose. So what's the gene at work which keeps pushing you to say, and when we talk about this, I actually want you to share the process with everyone here, because I know you, and I know that there is a process that you go through when you start beginning to engage with the film.
Yeah.
Share with them the process. How does it happen? How does Peoply Life get made? How does Deli Belly get made? How do films that are completely coming out of nowhere suddenly arrive and grab your time and attention and money and end up as absolutely path-breaking projects?
Well, you know, the thing is that I have to admit that the fear factor is there in me also. So with success, you're right, you have a lot more to lose, and then you're wondering whether this will work or not. So with each film that I do, it's not that I'm now fearless or I'm, you know, every time that I've, you know, embarked on a film, in the first few stages of the film, starting, you know, when we start working on it, I'm always like, my God, have we done the right thing? Matlab, kuch tafda hone wala hai, and you know, that nervousness is always there, and the stress is always there, the fear is always there, so it hasn't ever gone. But to give you an example, for example, let's say Deli Belly. Now, Deli Belly, how did it happen? It happened one day, I was answering an email. My wife, Kiran, was getting impatient with me, and we were supposed to go out somewhere. And she said, come on, hurry up. And there's usually a big pile of scripts lying on my study table. And while waiting for me, she picked up a script and began reading it. And then she started laughing, and she kept laughing. And after like 5 minutes, she was rolling on the floor. So I said, what are you reading here? And she said, this is a really bizarre, really funny script. So I said, what's it called? And she said, whatever, Deli Belly. And the way she was laughing right through that reading, eventually we didn't go out that night. After she finished reading the script, I began reading it. And then I just cracked up. I found it really funny. And then I called the guys, you know, whose name was written on it. They are these two boys from LA who had come down to Bombay and who had spent 2 months trying to meet me, and I couldn't meet them. And they had just reached back to LA. So when I called that number, they said, oh, we just reached back. And then I said, I just read your script, I liked it, and they came over. And then we began to make it. Now, it's a very unusual script for sure, and for Indian cinema, it's primarily in English. Also, it's extremely irreverent, a lot of abusive language. It's not stuff that we are used to seeing, you know, coming out of Indian cinema. But I just thought it was fun. So, yes, there's a lot of risk involved. Now, what I try to do, each of these films, whether it was Rang De Basanti, which was 4 Bhagat Singhs had been made previous year, or Tare Zameepur, or any of these stories, are very lovely scripts to begin with, you know. And what I try to do is that first I go with my heart and my creative instinct and my emotion as a human being. I just love something, I want to do it. When we actually sit down to do it, we try, and then that's when my practical side kicks in. And I want to make sure that while we are experimenting, while we are doing something unusual and different, I don't want to fail at it. And in most cases, when we talk of cinema, which is a business as along with, you know, a creative art, what fails often is the budgeting of the film. And so if you're practical about what the potential of a film is, and then you aim for that scale, and you manage to pull it off in that, you know, like Tare Zameepur cost us 8 crores to make, which is 1/3 the budget of Lagaan. Mm. And it was made almost 8 years after Lagaan. So if you look at the practical side, you can actually make sure you don't lose money at least. So I believe as a creative person, I want to do what I want to do. And I want to have the freedom to do what I want to do. But along with that freedom comes a responsibility. I don't want the market to lose money on me. I don't want anyone to lose money on me. You know, I grew up in a household. I mean, my father is a producer. He made a lot of successful films, but he never made money. He was always in debt. He was, for years on end, we'd have people calling up and people he'd borrowed money from, and you know, from the market, and he couldn't return the money for very long. And so he had a lot of financial problems right through. So I've seen a producer go through all of that. I've seen people in the market go through all of that. Distributors, sub-distributors, theater owners. When a film doesn't do well, how it has a cascading effect. So I guess I grew up you know, having observed all of that, and I realized that if I really want to do the kind of cinema I want to do, then I should always make sure that no one loses money. I mean, I don't want to experiment on someone else's money. I don't want anyone to lose money. So I try and be responsible to the market. And I don't earn in the process, if it so happens. So what I do is I don't sell my films at an exorbitant price, which I can afford to with my name attached today with the success that I have. I don't do that. Instead, I take the risk of releasing the film. So the money side of it, what I try and do is, like, you know, you have these street performances when people perform and there's people standing and watching, then you finish the performance and you take your hat out and you go and collect money.
Right. Well said.
If people have liked your show, they'll put money in it. If they haven't liked your show, they'll walk away. So I believe in that. I believe that if people have liked my film, then more tickets will be sold and eventually I'll get that money.
I have to just tell the audience that he's probably the only major actor in the cinema, because he also backs and produces films, who pretty much often tail ends his own earnings, which means he doesn't take the big money up front. He says, we'll make the film, but this is what I'll take if the film succeeds. And that's really having self-belief in what you're pursuing and putting yourself out on the line. Amir, you spoke about how the kind of financial vicissitudes of your own childhood in some sense impacted your own approach to the business of filmmaking. Tell us a little bit more about what it was about your childhood that has shaped you as a cinema person, because you come from a cinema family.
Yeah.
You know, and as you come from a conventional cinema family, you know, I mean, people who are involved in conventional cinema, but and you've then made this marriage where you've kind of made a bridge between conventional and the unconventional, or you know. So what else is it about the childhood and your own experience living in this bubble of cinema, because you guys were born into it?
Yeah.
What was it about it that has actually shaped your own filmmaking?
I think a number of things when I look back. I mean, at that time when I was a kid, I didn't realize all these things were, that I was absorbing all of this. But I think today when I look back, I realize that first and foremost, the thing I loved about being part of a film family is you get to hear stories. So a lot of writers and directors would come and meet my dad and my uncle, and they would pitch stories and say, you know, Tar sahab, ek young ladki ki kahani hai, wo bichara ye kar raha hai, wo kar raha hai, you know, whatever. So I used to love to listen to stories. So hopefully if it would be a Sunday or a Thursday, my school had a Thursday off. So I would be at home and then, you know, there was a story session going on, I would sit in a corner and listen to the story. Not because I ever wanted to be in the films, but because I just loved listening to stories. So I would listen to a lot of stories. I've heard hundreds of ideas pitched, even, you know, full scripts, etc. Then there would be Bhappi Lahiri coming with his harmonium and tabla and, you know, playing music for my dad and Pancham uncle and, you know. So I've grown up watching music being created. I've been through the various processes of filmmaking. You know, a film is 20% complete. We have a screening. It's 80% complete. We have a screening. You've been through editing. So I was learning a lot of these things without actually realizing that I'm actually learning how to make films. The other thing that I think I've really learned from my dad and my uncle is two very important things here. One of them is that what they've taught me is that you have to be a team player. You know, filmmaking is about teamwork, and today, whatever success I've achieved, it looks like it's my success, but the fact is that all of these films have been written by writers who have come up with lovely scripts. You know, whether it's Rang De Basanti or Tare Zameepur or Lagan, I haven't written these scripts. Three Idiots, I've not written it. So these are script writers who've written wonderful scripts. They're directors who've made great films. The DOPs have done a wonderful job. The sound designers have done a wonderful job. The musical directors, the lyric writers, each one of the people in each of these films that I look back with a lot of satisfaction have had a great team working on it. So one of the big things I learned from both my uncle and my dad was that filmmaking is teamwork, and when a whole team works well, that's when a film comes out well. That was one. The other thing is that what I learned from them and picked up from them is the values that they lived with. My father and my uncle both were very straight people, and that's what I admired about them as human beings. So I think that's an important thing I've imbibed from them. the values with which they worked.
You've just given a great deal of credit to your scriptwriters and your directors. Now tell me, is it the fact that you have a fantastic eye in being able to pick talent, or is it the case that you put a huge multiplier into ordinary talent? Because a lot of the people who have succeeded hugely with you have actually not when they've been without you. And this includes directors and scriptwriters. So what is the kind of quality of multiplier that you end up putting into any project, you know, that lifts both the director and the scriptwriter?
You know, I feel I've worked with really talented people. Certainly I have contributed to each of my films. And perhaps I have contributed not just as an actor, but as a film person. And I'm also glad that my directors, the people that I've worked with, have had the kind of relationship with me that they have, invited my participation.
So give the audience a sense. Let's pick Rang De Basanti or Lagaan. So let's say at the script level, what would your level of engagement be?
Okay, Lagaan on the script level, I just did a bit of editing on the script. The original had the cricket match was a two-inning match. So the film is 4 hours, it would have been 8 hours. And so I told Ashu, I said, Ashu, do innings mat kar bhai. Ek inning mein hum log kar lenge yaar jo karna hai. So my contribution to the script was I made it a one inning and not a two inning. Otherwise, the script was as it is.
Screenplay?
Screenplay also, I had nothing to contribute. Very, very minor, maybe just one or two things here and there. I had a major amount of contribution perhaps in the post-production, in the edit. The edit of the film.
Tell us about that.
Well, the first cut was around 7.5 hours. No, I'm not exaggerating. It really was. The portion up till the cricket match was 4.5 hours. And each day of the cricket, there are 3 days of the cricket in the film, each day of the cricket was 1 hour. So it was about 7.5 hours. So when we had the first screening, all of us were shell-shocked. And we were so tired by the end of it. We were like, my God. And then I remember Anil Mehta, we saw the film, at a private screening hall, and then we were driving back to the office. So Anil Mehta and I were driving back together, and Anil was ashen-faced, he was like, all of us thinking we've spent 2 years of our lives making this film. And it's just a piece of shit. So, we were driving back and Anil said, "To, abhi kya hoga?" So I said, "Anil, super hit hai apni picture." I was saying it partly to give him some encouragement, but partly I believed that it wasn't cut, the way it, of course it was also the first cut, Ashu as a director had just done the first cut. And it really needed, a first cut of 7 hours is not a joke. So we had a lot of work to do. And then I sat with Ashu on the edit. So I think my major contribution in Lagaan was probably on the edit.
So how many days or weeks would you have sat on the edit?
Oh, we probably cut it for 6 months.
6 months?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, we worked on the final cut for about 6 months. And went back and forth and, it was a very enjoyable process because Ballu, the editor, and Ashu and I also really enjoyed the process of going through each scene, figuring out where to cut it, keeping the essence as it is. But, and remember Lagaan, you can't mess with the pace so much because it is a slightly classical format. If you hurry it too much,
you lose
the flavor of the film, which you can't afford to do. So it was a tricky thing, but we enjoyed the process. I really love the editing process. I have to say a lot of my contribution, like even in Rang De perhaps, has come in the post-production stage.
I have to
In Rang De, I also actually ended up contributing in the climax. I ended up suggesting to them what the climax.
What was it originally?
Originally, what was the climax is that after we end up killing the defense minister, we try to escape from the city. And each one of us gets shot in different places. So I asked Mehra, I said, "Yaar, I love your script. The end doesn't make sense to me because why are they running? Do they feel they've done something wrong? Because essentially they feel they've done something right. Why are they running?" So he was like, "Yeah, why are they running?" So
So I said, I don't think they should run. And also because throughout the film, you've kept a parallel. Throughout the film, your parallel is Bhagat Singh and his era and the current guys. And I said, Bhagat Singh didn't run away. In fact, he threw a bomb in the parliament and gave himself up and through the court proceedings, expressed what he had to. So he got arrested by choice and then expressed what he had to. So I said, even these guys, therefore, shouldn't run away. Keep the parallel that you've kept throughout the film. Keep it till the end. And so he said, so what do you think, what should it be? And there was a story that I had written many years ago for myself. And I had written this climax, you know, where the in my version, there were two guys. And it reaches a situation where they need to communicate with society. So they forcibly enter a television studio and they take over by force the television studio. And then because they are going on live, they can start talking to people. So I took that and I told Mehra, I said, yaar, ye kahani meri ek thi jo main ab to khair banaunga nahi because the climax is gone. But he liked it, and so we fitted that climax into Rang De Basanti, and you know, that's how Rang De Basanti. So it depends, you know, sometimes my contribution, like Tare Zameen Par, the script was as it is. I had barely, I mean, I had nothing to contribute. It was entirely Amol's script. Of course, there I was a director myself. But in Three Idiots, for example, I had very little to contribute.
Raju wasn't fully.
Raju is a great writer, he's a great director. So I think it depends, you know, I mean, to different degrees. Perhaps in Three Idiots, the contribution I made was a lot on my character. Because the way Raju had written it originally, Rancho was a guy who was very... He had all the funny, smart one-liners, and he was a bit of a hero. So in his introduction, if you've seen the film, when they're ragging the first-year guys, he walks in and he gives some smart comments and oh, shock walk de deta hai. But the whole scene was written with a lot of hero-giri. And he's the guy who's giving the one-liners and all of that. And even with the principal after that, he's constantly scoring, you know. And the attitude the writers had taken, Raju and Abhijat, was that he's a bit cocky, I felt, you know. So I said, Raju, I have one fear. I like the script. I have one fear. Rancho, right now, the way you've written him, by the time one third of the film is over, people are going to get really irritated with him. Itna ded shana hai wo yaar. Har cheez ke liye, he's got an answer and, you know, he's got no flaws.
Yeah.
You know, it's very difficult to play a character which has got no flaws because the audience doesn't love you. They may admire you, but they don't love you. They emotionally, they're not attached to you. You know, Farhan's character, which is played by Maddie, your heart goes out to him because he actually wants to do something else. His father is, you know, giving him a hard time and his heart is in something else and he's crying and, you know, he wants to do that. Sharman's character has got, you know, he's very poor, his family is... Father is unwell, his mother is constantly washing bartans. So, but your heart goes out to him because, you know, he's scared, he's constantly praying, you know, so you feel, arre yaar, poor chap.
But
Rancho has got no problem in life. He's very good in studies, he's very smart, he's giving left, right and all, sabko, you know. So I said, yaar, he'll get on your nerves. After a point, he'll really get on your nerves. So he said, what do you suggest? I said, what I suggest is, that I don't play it the way you've written it. You've written it over smart. Let me not play it that way. So let me play it that he's very excited and he's very childlike and he's very curious. So he's saying the same things, but he's not saying it to be funny. For example, with the principal, when the principal says, ye astronaut pen hai aur ye space mein bhi chalta hai falana dimka, pata nahi kitne billion ka hai. Aur jo, अच्छा स्टूडेंट रहेगा उसको मैं दूंगा एंड ऑल दैट 32 साल से मैंने किसी को दिया नहीं है. रैंचो इज लाइक अरे यार व्हाई डिड द एस्ट्रोनॉट्स यूज अ पेंसिल. सो हिज माइंड इज ऑलरेडी गॉन टू दैट. सो व्हेन द स्पीच गेट्स ओवर ही सेज सर व्हाई डिड यू यूज अ पेंसिल. नो ही इज एक्चुअली आस्किंग इट वेरी वेरी ही इज एक्साइटेड. एवरीवन लाफ्स. ही लुक्स बिहाइंड के लोग हंस क्यों रहे यार मैं जोक तो नहीं कर रहा हूं मैं तो एक्चुअली पूछ रहा हूं. सो
What I did is I tried to make him a guy who's just curious, like when he tells the principal that kya first school hai yaar? What first?
So does it irritate your friends that you have no flaws?
नहीं यार No, I
okay, no, let me rephrase flaws. That question. I was once talking to Imran the first time I met him, your nephew, and I said, listen, boss.
Cricketer.
Nahi, apna Imran.
Achha, my nephew.
Your nephew. So I told Imran, I said, boy, you're so much better looking than your mamu. So he held my hand and said, please don't tell mamu that. Mamu's damn competitive, I'll be in trouble. So I know you were a tennis champ. You played tennis at the state and national level when you were in school. Has sport and the kind of discipline and metabolism of sport also in some sense shaped the kind of person you are even in filmmaking, you know?
Actually, in a strange way, you know, I haven't thought of it, but now that you asked me this question, it certainly struck me. I used to be pretty good at tennis, you know, and my parents were rather unhappy about that because I was not studying, you know, as a result, I would never be in school or, you know, I would spend 5 hours a day on the tennis court. So I remember they said, isko tennis ka bhoot sawar ho gaya, to iska school badlo. So they put me in Bombay Scottish, which is another school, which basically the timings were 9 to 5. Earlier the school used to get over by 1 o'clock. So 2 o'clock I was on the court. To bhi 5-6 baje tak main ghar aata tha, I couldn't play tennis. So I missed out on my, you know, practice time. But I still entered the inter-school and, you know, the tournaments. So I realized that, yeah, I'm not playing as well. I mean, we luckily still won the inter-school, but I wasn't on that level, obviously, if you're not playing every day. And then, of course, they just stopped my tennis entirely because they felt I should really concentrate on my studies. So my tennis got stopped, but my studies didn't benefit in any way because of that. But what I learned on that, I remember, you know, you're asking me this and I'm remembering that when I became an actor, I realized in the early years of my career, I said, yaar, wo jo galti maine tennis mein ki na, of not practicing, wo main isme nahi karunga. I'm not going to allow myself to fall short in any way. Because I used to feel really horrible when I used to not play as well as I thought I could play or as well as I wanted to play. So I remember that thought coming to me repeatedly in the early years of my career as an actor, that the mistake I made over there. So maybe in that sense, it made me more sharper in my application towards what I'm doing. And I, you know, decided that I cannot leave any stone unturned towards whatever I'm doing. But the overall thing, you know, the most important thing, Tarun, is yes, I'm competitive. A lot of us are competitive. But the bottom line is that I enjoy what I'm doing. And not only do I enjoy what I'm doing, I enjoy what other people are doing. Which means that when I say Munna Bhai, I'm not in Munna Bhai. And I don't even know Raju at that point of time. I was floored by the film. Yeah, I loved it. And the film gave me so much joy. I mean, I thought it's the best film I'd seen, you know, Munna Bhai Lage Raho, with Gandhiji in it. And it's not my film, but I just love the way Sanju performed it. I just love the way Raju directed it. So if I'm just competitive, I'll not feel that. You know, when I see Dilwale, for example, Shah Rukh's film, I just think it's a fab film, man. And I think Shah Rukh has done exceptionally well in that film. So when I look at someone's work, I think Ranbir is a hugely talented actor. When I look at someone's work, I may be competitive, but that's on a very side level. What's more important to me is that I get really happy when I see good work. Whether it's my good work or other people's good work, it just gives me joy. And I think that is what makes me what I am, because I enjoy what I'm doing.
Also some... You know, I mean, if there's one trait that defines stars and certainly superstars, it's narcissism, you know. I mean, this is the great narcissism of the mirror, the narcissism of fans. With someone like you, I always feel you live with a much deeper narcissism, which is about a legacy, you know. And And it's not the obvious narcissism, because I know you have extremely ordinary friends. Your trip in life
obvious
is not...
Obvious narcissism bhi hai.
Oh, that happened. Okay. Okay. But obviously, clearly, there's a much deeper narcissism about a legacy and about the body of work and about the quality of the work that's being done. That's very unusual in Indian cinema. You know, you really have to go all the way back, as I said, to Guru Dutt and Bimal Roy, and at least Guru Dutt and Raj Kapoor were also stars themselves. But you have to really go back all the way there to find that quality of narcissism which says, what I'm creating has a life beyond just the day's box office. There is something here that it's an art form. I'll make it simpler. That it's also an art form. It's a money game. It's an entertainment game. It's a spectacle. But it's also an art form. And this has to be pulled off with some degree of excellence, that as much of excellence as I can summon.
Yeah, you know, I don't. That's not how I'm looking at it, I have to say. When I'm doing my films right from QSQT onwards, I never thought that I'm making a film that will be very... साल बाद लोग याद करेंगे और यू नो और लगान व्हेन वी वर मेकिंग लगान इट आई वाजंट थिंकिंग दैट ओ ही वाज अ फिल्म आई एम मेकिंग सो आई डोंट थिंक आई बीन थिंकिंग लाइक दैट
इज इट इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर यू ह्यूजली
टुडे इट इज आई मीन इफ यू आस्क मी इफ यू आस्क मी डायरेक्ट क्वेश्चन इज इट इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर यू टू लीव बिहाइंड अ लेगेसी ऑफ वर्क दैट यू आर प्राउड ऑफ येस ऑफ कोर्स इट इज बट दैट्स नॉट व्हाई आई एम डूइंग दैट फिल्म और दैट्स नॉट व्हाई आई एम वर्किंग द वे आई एम वर्किंग बिकॉज आई लाइक दैट स्क्रिप्ट एंड आई वॉन्ट टू डू इट यू नो if you told me that Lagaan is going to be a flop, which everyone told me in any case, and you should not do it because it's going to be a disaster, I'll still do it because I love it. So you take any of my films, everyone who loved me told me don't do Lagaan. They all said don't do Rang De Basanti. Char dafa ban chuki hai yaar, tum phir banane ja rahe ho, had dogi. Tare Zameen Par, I remember a very good friend of mine when I showed him the film, my first test screening of Tare Zameen Par, my friends almost beat me up. I'm not kidding. Prasun ji, aap to the wahan pe, Amin aur Kareem and all of them, they said, you know, you made a documentary, ye kya bana diya tumne? A friend of mine told me, isko release mat karo. Kuch karo, isko yaar kitna kharcha kiya, 8 crore main deta hoon yaar, tum isko release mat karo. So people didn't like, they were being protective, you know, because people who loved me felt, pata nahi main kya kar raha hun. But I enjoyed what I'm doing and I believed in what I was doing, and so I did it. It was not with the thought that here's something I'm making which is going to stand the test of time. All of us hope that, all filmmakers hope that I would make a film which stands the test of time, and if you can have one such film in your career,
you've done well.
You know, you've done well. So all of us would like that, but you can't plan that. You just can't plan that. You have to, I really believe that more of us need to feel a little more free in our hearts to do what we actually feel like doing. And that may not make sense to the market, but then you have to be responsible. But you should do it. Importantly, I think more of us will start making better and better films if we do what we believe in doing and if we do what we really feel like doing, as opposed to what we feel people would like to watch. And, you know, more importantly, the result of that will be that at least you'll make what you want. Sure. At least, even if you fail on your terms, you fail doing what you set out to do. And at least one person will be happy with the film, that's you. Because you have no idea how other people are going to react in any case.
Is Amir the secret of your connect with audiences, you know, audiences that range from all classes, is all the way right up to the top. Is the secret of that, I'm asking you a kind of introspective question, your own way of approaching things in a very simple and straight and clear fashion? Do you think it's what makes it easier for you to intuit audiences in a way that, you know, a more complicated and messy ways of seeing don't do often, you know?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think that cinema is also, you know, cinema is a medium in which is, it's a mass medium. You're actually communicating with a lot of people and you're hoping to communicate with a lot of people. So you need to have, I mean, you just have to be excited about what you're doing. I've given this example earlier and I'll give it again. Filmmaking is storytelling. So imagine there's a party going on and there are 20, 30 of us sitting in a room. Music baj raha hai and we are chatting and I tell you, Tarun yaar, koi achhi kahani bata. Tell me something interesting has happened in your life. So you'll think of something and you'll
wonder what to tell me, and eventually you will think of something and you tell me ki haan yaar once this happened or whatever. Now imagine the same party happening, same situation but slightly different. The doorbell rings and you walk in. Party is going on and you say, guys, you won't believe what happened. The most amazing thing happened to me, yaar. Main aa raha tha yaar wo auto mein. Now that story is a story that you feel like telling. So you will also stop the music and say, arey yaar music band karo, Amir listen to me, and you know you'll grab our attention and then you will tell the story. The reason is that you have a story to tell, and there's a certain excitement that you have within you which you want to share with everyone, and so you will find a way to tell that story well. And that's what I say, you know, when I'm working with filmmakers, people ask me this question, like you earlier asked me, ki how come filmmakers, they've done such good work with you, and then perhaps when they've not been working with you, they haven't, the films have not worked as much. And it's a very awkward question to me because I don't know how to answer this. And the fact is, I mean, people assume I have ghost directed. It's absurd. Why the hell will I give the credit to somebody else? So why should I ghost direct here? These are all very talented directors. They've done amazing work. And then when I began thinking myself that what is it, and I thought that, yaar, I think one of the reasons is that all of these directors had a story to tell, and that's what connected with me. You know, Ashutosh had a story to tell when he came to me with Lagaan, or you know, Farhan had a story to tell when he came to me with Dil Chahta Hai, all of them. And I think that it's an intangible thing which is in you as a director when you have a story to tell and you want to tell it and you're dying to tell it, and then you figure out a way of telling it well.
Yes.
And then people also ask me ke something about marketing. You're some marketing guru, they keep calling me. There's no marketing guru here. I just feel that the excitement with which that you've made a film, that action of you saying music band karo, Amir listen to me, is marketing. You're getting everyone's attention when you're telling the story. So if you made a film with a lot of love and excitement and passion and you want to reach out to people, you will find a way to reach people. And that automatically, people will sense that these guys are excited about telling us this film. And I think that is the key for me, you know, that intangible feeling inside you, which is either there or not there.
Two quick last questions. One is, I know you don't watch cinema too much. You actually prefer to read.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's the story behind that?
Yeah, you know, the thing is that I belong to a film family, but strangely my parents are, you know, very conservative and all of that, and we wouldn't get permission to watch films. So apart from our own films that my dad was making, we used to watch those, but but otherwise I would be like, you know, all of us kids would be, ammi film dekhna hai, so she would say, are abhi 8 mahine pehle to wo dekhi tumne. I'm like, 8 mahine pehle was like long back, yeah. And then of course Bobby, you're not allowed to see Bobby because Bobby's a romantic film and all of that. So I think as a kid growing up, I never got into this whole groove of watching films, you know. And it's not that I don't enjoy watching films, I love watching films. In fact, when I'm an ideal audience, I laugh, I cry, I shout out, you know, to the characters on screen. I don't blink when I'm watching a film. My eyes start hurting, you know, then I remember, hey, yaar, I should blink. So it's not that I don't enjoy watching films, I love watching films. But I somehow never get down to doing it because I'm not in the habit of it, I don't know what it is.
And the reading?
Reading, I began reading when I was 7 years old, and I just fell in love with it, and I used to read a lot. I used to read a lot, so
Does that shape your attitudes to filmmaking?
I think it has shaped my
approaches.
Ability to... I think it has shaped the way I think. I think when you're reading a book, if you're reading a good author, good authors can be very evocative. And they, when you're reading them, there's a picture that's forming in your mind. Even of the location, when they're describing a place, there's a picture that's forming in your mind, you know? So what I feel is that books can really shape the way you think. And even as an actor, it gives you a lot into characters. like when you read the opening scene of Anna Karenina, and the way that Tolstoy has described, you know, how, what is the guy who has an affair? Oblonsky or something? I'm very bad with names.
Bronsky.
Yeah, yeah.
Bronsky.
And his wife says something, and then, you know, he's had an affair, and his wife has got him. And then suddenly she's screaming at him, and then suddenly he says, I don't know why, but he smiled, you know. That the way it is described at moment, you know. So it gives you a lot of cues as an actor as well.
One last question before we go. In your own sort of these 20 years, when you were entering cinema and through these years, are there a few actors before your time, off your time, who actually are inspirational or mean something to you, actors or directors?
Yeah, I think I've really liked watching Dilip Kumar, Amit Ji, Naseer, Om. I've really liked Nargis. Actually, so many actors, you know, I find every time I watch a film, I see things that I learn from it. Govinda. You know, I'm a big fan of Govinda. Shammi Kapoor. I think Govinda's sense of timing is so wonderful, and his sense of humor. He's one of the few actors who, when I'm watching television, which is not very often, but whenever I do, if I see a Govinda film, you know, when you're flipping channels, that's where my remote stops. And I end up watching the film because I find him really funny.
So here we have a fan of Govinda, but one of the greatest actors and producers in the history of Indian cinema. So, thank you, Amit. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.